Hello, hello, hello. Happy Sunday and good morning to some, good afternoon to some, and good evening to some of you. I am Apostle Claire Revealed, the founder of the Gathering of the Intercessors movement. Hallelujah. I am based in Holland. I also have another movement called Prayer Warriors Arise, and I am the senior pastor of Zion International Intercessory Ministries. We have a church. Hallelujah. Today is Sunday. I'm supposed to be in church, but for some reason, all the roads in my city are blocked because God bless you, Sister Jadeska, because there is a marathon in my city. Hallelujah. So I thought to myself, why not have church with my Facebook online family and friends? God bless you. Today I'm going to have on this program a guest. Please help me share. Hallelujah. Help me share this and help me tap on that friends button and invite your friends. Some of them are home and they are not in church, so you want to get them here. So today I'm going to be having a guest on this broadcast with me. It's my own very spiritual daughter, who is actually my sister, Prophetess Sally D. You know, she's been burning with a word in her spirit and she's been sounding the alarm. But I don't know if people are really hearing her. So I'm here as a mother and an apostle to help her get her voice out there. I want the world to hear what she is saying and what the Spirit is saying to the church. So while you are joining me, I will ask you to help me share this broadcast on your timeline. You have some groups that you are part of. I'm not talking about the gathering of the intercessors. You have groups beside the gathering of the intercessors. Hallelujah. Can you please, right now, share this in your groups? Amen. And then tap on the friend button. You will invite friends to watch us. So Prophetess Sally is going to be joining me in a minute. And so while I'm waiting for her, I just encourage you to comment, release prophetic word, share, and invite friends while we listen to wonderful worship. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. My lip always cracking. That's why I put Vaseline on my lips because they are always like a kind of dry. So let me get our friends on board. Hallelujah. Bless you. Just comment, share, 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 invite, invite, invite. And whatever you feel in your spirit, just release it on the comments. Amen. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Sister Judiska. Thank you all who are sharing. Invite friends as well. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jehovah. Thank you, Jehovah God. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank Somebody glorify him. We stand in you. I see Ivana online. God bless you, Ivana. God bless you, Sister Paula. Ivana, can you also help me share? Good morning. God bless you also richly. Can you share this, Ivana, and invite your friends? Help me, help me, help me. In Jesus' name. You will see the friends invite button. Click on it and invite friends. Jesus, breathe on us. Thank you for sharing. Thank you for inviting friends. God bless you, Sister Ada. Good morning. Help me share this. Help me invite your friends. Hallelujah. God bless you, Nelly. Share this. Help me invite your friends. Holy Ghost, thank you. Blessings to everyone. God bless you, Shanti. Welcome. Invite your friends. Wake them up. Call them wherever they are. Let them know it's going to be hot in this place. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Father. We bless you, Lord. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Good morning, Prophetess Sally.
Good morning, Apostle Claire. Good morning. God bless you. Good morning, everyone online. God bless you.
So the thing is, I'm going to give you a 2 minutes to share and invite all your friends while I'm doing the same. Yes. Hallelujah. So just share, invite everybody that you can invite. Let's get the crowd and then we can start. Good morning, everyone online. It's going to be a good time, so don't move. God is going to touch you today. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Everybody sharing, everybody inviting friends. Wake them up. Thank you, Father. Not by might. Okay, I want all the prophetic people online begin to decree something over this broadcast and to the atmosphere. Come on, build it up. Build it up. Build it up. Oh, Rabasakara Bakashanta. Mantoria Bakasande. Menteri Bakasande. Manta Rabayoso Korobo Shekerebosa. Manterebe Kesende. Menteri Bakandoria. We bless you, Lord. We bless you, Adonai. We worship you, God. We give you praise. Oops. Anybody online praying? Kunda. Are you people praying with me? Oh, Rabba Kassandiria Basaya. Masakaraba Senderebosa. Minte Rabba Kassandi. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Father. Let your glory.
We give you adoration this hour, Lord. You are wonderful. You are gracious. Nobody but you, Jesus. Nobody like you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Oh, yes, Jesus. Father, we bless you today. Hallelujah. We stand in an awe of you, God. We stand in an awe of you, God. We stand in an awe of you, God. Thank you, Jesus. We stand in awe of you. We stand in an awe of you. We stand in an awe of you, God. We stand in an awe of you, Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah.
How many of you know that God is doing a new thing?
Amen.
God's decree new thing. Come on, new thing, right here, new thing.
Amen. Father, you are doing a new. We are in the new season. New thing.
Father, we just thank you this morning, this afternoon,
yes,
God.
Lord.
We just
thank
bless
you, Jesus.
God. We just glorify you. We just magnify
yes,
you.
Lord.
We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor. We give you adoration. We give
yes,
you thanks,
Jesus.
God. You are highly exalted, Lord.
Hallelujah.
You, Lord Jehovah. Jehovah, we worship you. We bless your name, Father. Father, I thank you for Prophetess Sally and myself,
yes,
those online.
Thank you, Jesus.
We thank you for this new day in
yes,
Holland.
Father, we
sunny
give you all the praise.
I decree
yes, Lord,
and declare a sunny day upon
Jesus.
Your people, God.
Oh,
that
yes, God, let me be a new season, my God.
We
cover
a new place in a new
God.
Dimension.
Release your blood.
In the name of Jesus,
your blood.
That
release your blood.
Your presence.
In
we
the name
the
of
blood.
Jesus. Yes, Lord.
By the blood of Jesus.
By the blood of Jesus, we release your blood. We release your blood over this atmosphere. We release your blood today, God. We release your blood. Your blood, Jesus. Your blood. We release your blood right now. In Jesus' name.
Hallelujah. Father, we just thank you.
Yes,
I release
Lord.
All of those who are sick online. I
Amen.
Declare healing over you.
Yes, Lord.
In the name,
of Jesus.
Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
And Prophet Salim. When I'm speaking, you need to, because if not, we get echo. Amen. So
Amen.
When you are speaking, I'm quiet. When I'm speaking, you are quiet so that the people don't get double sounds at the same time.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Good morning, everybody. We are excited to be here today. Like I said with the opening, we were supposed to have church, but because of roadblocks in our city, we are deciding to have church here anyway. So how many of you can say glory to Jesus? Hallelujah.
Amen.
And I'm just thanking God for what God is doing in this season. I'm so excited. I'm blessed. I'm favored. And I know it's the same with everybody in this broadcast. Hallelujah. I decided to come online to do church with you all, but I didn't just want to come alone. I wanted to come with Prophetess Sally because, you know, I'm a prophetic woman. So I always know when God is sounding an alarm. But unfortunately, sometimes we've become so used to voices and we're listening to too many voices that when God is speaking to us specifically and a particular voice is being released to tell us what God is saying, we don't listen to what God is saying through that voice. Amen. So it's important when you are listening to messages, listening to the repetition. God will always repeat things when people are not getting it. Is somebody with me today? Amen. So I've been listening to Prophetess Sally. Of course, she's a daughter in my ministry. And she has such a prophetic insight and she has a burning heart for God, number one. She has a burning heart for the things of God, and she has a burning heart for the people of God. And I've known her all my life because she's also my sister. I think as she grows in God, her greatest desire is to see the people of God free and blessed. Can somebody Amen. Just hashtag free and blessed? You know, her desire is to see people be free, come to Christ, be free and blessed. Yes, and I amen. Think those of you watching us today, you have been marked by God to be free and to be blessed in the name of Jesus. Somebody amen. Better get excited this morning time.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. If you are just if you are just joining us and you have not shared this broadcast and you have not invited your friends, please do that now, okay? Let's be with the spirit of generosity, love, and unity right here. Right there is all about God. So you sharing is not like you are. Of course, when you share, you also help to promote me and promote us and the work of God. But then you are sowing a seed. When you help one person, God will raise up people to help you.
Amen.
By the way, why I have all of you here, if you have not registered for my mentorship classes, this is a good day for you to connect and register to my online. I have an online private mentorship classes. I'm training and teaching in that group. And we're going to take off from next week and go higher. Amen. So join the group. If you're not part of it yet, ask me information through a messenger. And I'm going to send you the link on how to connect. Amen. So today we want to talk about Arise and Shine. That's something that Prophetess Sally has been sounding that alarm for so long, but I don't think that her voice is really getting the attention that she needs, you know, and I think it's a pity because people watch her, they jump, but I don't think people really get it, but I want you online today to get it. Somebody hashtag,
Amen.
I will get it. I will get it. Just hashtag, write down, I will get it. So, first and foremost, there is a verse that carries that is the embodiment of Arise and Shine. I'm going to let Prophetess Sally to go there, and then we are going to read it together, not the whole chapter, of course, maybe from verse 1 and 3 or 4, as God leads. So we want to go to the book of Isaiah 60. Isaiah 60, amen? So let's get Isaiah 60 written down, and then she's going to read from verse 1 to where she wants to stop, and then I'm going to ask her about her passion and her desire in this topic. Amen. Can you read for us, Prophetess?
Amen. It says from verse 1, arise, shine, for the light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. For behold, darkness shall cover the earth, and deep darkness the people. But the Lord will arise over you, and his glory will be seen upon you. The Gentiles shall come to their light, and the kings to the brightness of your rising. So lift up your eyes all around and see. They are all gathered together and they come to you. Your sons shall come from afar, your daughters, and your daughter shall be nursed at your side. Then I'll end at verse 5. Then you shall see and become radiant, and your heart shall swell with joy, because the abundance of the sea shall be turned to you. The wealth of the Gentile shall come to you. Amen.
Amen. So, can you, first and foremost, you must have a reason why you are sounding this alarm. Can you tell me about your passion? What God placed upon your heart in this time concerning arising and shining?
Thank you, Pastor Claire. Concerning arising and shining, what God has placed in my heart in this season, as the Bible, the verse says, it said, darkness shall be upon the earth and gross darkness the people. So, but gross darkness will be upon the people. But there's a promise in that. It said, but the darkness shall not come before you, closer to you, and deep darkness the people, but the Lord will arise over you.
Wow.
The Lord himself. So many people, God says, arise, shine. Very short and very powerful. God is saying, I command you to arise and shine. He said, not only for you to arise and shine. He said, but my glory, why? Because my glory is upon you. Yes, there is darkness upon the earth. Yes, there is gross darkness, deep darkness upon the people. But my glory that is upon you will cause you to be different. There are many children of God who are walking so gloomy. Their head is not lifted up. They don't have hope in life. Some, even right from the pulpit, are killing themselves, not knowing God is commanding them to arise and shine, not knowing that the darkness that is in the earth cannot touch them, not knowing that there is a promise over their life that when they arise and stand, then no one know your identity.
My God. I think she's a kind of freezing. She has to get her internet and sorted. Hallelujah. You know, when God is calling you, it is up to us to hear what God is saying to the church. It's not enough to hear a message and don't hear the message behind, but hear the voice behind the message. And the voice behind the message shouldn't be the voice of the person releasing the message, but it ought to be the voice of God. You know, Prophetess Sally, you need to go off Facebook and come back. If not, you can't join anymore. Hallelujah. So when somebody is saying, arise and shine, what I love about that scripture is that God is saying, I myself, God, I will arise upon you. Do you know the scriptures in Psalms 91? Psalms 91 says, 1,000 shall fall at the side and 10,000 at the right hand, but that plague will not come near your dwelling. It means you are a separated, unique person, that things may be happening around you. Things may be... Prophetess Sally, go off Facebook totally. Lock off Facebook and then come back. Amen. Now you are right on track again. Hallelujah. So it says that 1,000 shall fall at the side and 10,000 at the right hand, but that plague shall not come near thy dwelling. So that's what is also in Isaiah 60, when God is saying that darkness, thick darkness, everything will be happening around you. But he said, but with your case, you are different. Just Amen. Continue where you ended, please.
It says, the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. Deep darkness upon the people on the earth, but deep darkness upon the people. There is darkness on the earth, but the greatest darkness, God is saying, is not on the earth, it's upon the people. Meaning the people, because God gives the people dominion over the earth. So if the devil wants to mess up the earth, he will put darkness, gross darkness in the people, because the people have authority over the earth. So God is saying, arise and shine. So my passion is, I want people to arise. I want people to know who they are and whose they are. You belong to God. You are the daughter of the king or the son of the king. So knowing your position will cause you to arise and shine. Many people are gifted. Many people are anointed from the day they were born. But the enemy has kept them through the voice of people, telling them you can amount to nothing, telling them you cannot make it in life, telling them that when you look at them, you see the talent of God. I worked on Friday. I was watching a young boy. This boy is so talented. But this child has been kept in a place where nobody, he cannot lift up his head. All he does the whole day is make puzzles. But this child can write down 10 scriptures without batting an eye. And he writes them out perfectly. That is a gift. But because the parents are ignorant or I don't understand, he is kept in a place where he cannot grow. He is kept in a place where he cannot function. And that is the state of many people in the body of Christ. They are gifted, they are talented, but because somebody tell them you are a woman, somebody tell them you cannot do it, somebody, maybe the voice of their mother tell them or their leader or whatever society, they end up sitting back and just sitting. But there is a gift in them. So God is saying, no, that gift, I put it there for a reason. It is your time to arise and shine. Go out and fulfill purpose.
Yes. Wow. There is something you said that I really need to speak about that a bit. I want to press on that. You said that there's going the scripture says there is darkness upon the earth and gross darkness, which means greater darkness upon the people. So amen. Darkness upon the earth and greater darkness upon the people. But you arise and shine. Amen. So if we don't arise and shine in this season, the darkness upon the earth is going to remain. And the darkness upon the people is going to remain. So what is God telling to you watching us this morning time? You are the light of the world.
Amen.
The darkness you see around you is not important as long as you arise and shine. Because you are the one that God has chosen in this season to cause the darkness to disappear. Because Amen. When light comes, it doesn't matter how much light is upon the earth. I mean, when darkness comes, no, when light comes, it doesn't matter how much darkness is upon the earth. It doesn't matter how much darkness is upon the people. The people could be your family, your church, your business, your city, your nation. The key to defeating that darkness is you arising as the light. Oh my God. Amen. I see a wind of the arising of the light coming. God Amen. Is raising up light, and that's you, because only light can conquer darkness. So you are not only arising to shine for yourself to be shining, but there is a work for you. There is a purpose for you to arise and shine. Mm-hmm. There is something that you need to defeat. But until you defeat that, until you arise, you cannot defeat that thing. Mm-hmm. Prophetess, you want to talk about that?
Until you arise, you cannot defeat that thing. We always say in our ministry when we are praying that an army sitting down is a defeated army. When you are in a battlefield, you have to stand up. So when you arise and shine, you have a clear view of what is happening. Because then the Bible says the glory of the Lord is upon you. So you are becoming light. In that light, you illuminate every place. So wherever things are hiding, spiritually, you will see it. How can you see? Because you are the light of the world. Yes. You have become yes. the light in that situation. Let me say for a family, they are going through a period of darkness, a period of mourning. When you start praying, when you start seeking God, when you start fasting, when you start soaking in the presence of God, God start bringing revelation to you. God start opening your eyes, say, oh, this is where the evil came in. This is where the door was opened. This is where the gate was opened. This is where a foothold was set and the enemy has a way in. So until you arise and you arise in a place of prayer, you arise in a place of intercession, you arise in a place of seeking God. Because only he will put his glory upon you and his glory will come so that you see things. And when you stand up tall, you see everything. You see everything. And if we check Ezekiel 37, that's what God did with Ezekiel. God picked him and put him to stand in the midst of the valley of dry bones. The dry bones has been there. It's Ezekiel chapter 37. So Ezekiel was existing from verse 1 to 36. But he never saw the bones. He never saw the house of Israel. He never saw the body of Christ being in a valley, rejected, broken, and shattered. But until God had to pick him up, then he could see. If you read in verse 36, the people of God were sinning. So Ezekiel started seeking God. So in his place of seeking God, God had to take him in verse 30, chapter 37 to see why they are where they are, so that he can fix them.
Amen. My God, that's so powerful. That's so powerful. God needs to take you from one place, cause you to arise. Until you rise up, you cannot see. Until you rise up in prayer, fasting, dedicating to God, being full-time with God, be planted in a church, and do what God asks you to do. Rise up in your Bible reading. You cannot see. Listen, Deborah was a prophetess, but also God assigned her as a governing woman, the set woman in the time in Israel. But when Deborah came to town, came to reign, the first thing she said, she began to give an account of all the things that the people of Israel were suffering with, the things they suffered, the battles they had, the oppression, the suppression, everything Israel was going through. But she said, until I, Deborah, arise. Are you hearing me? He said, until I arise, these things were dominating my family. These things were subduing my people. These things were causing my people to suffer. But when I arise, from that time of my arising, the battle became a different kind of battle.
Amen.
The enemy that used to suppress my people, now we begin to suppress them. Because Amen. Why? Amen. A woman decided to arise.
Right.
There are things that we are facing in this nation, in our nations, wherever you are watching us, in your family, in your situation, in your business, in your ministry, whatever it is, in your husband, in your wife, until you arise, that enemy is going to lift his head up. But it takes you to arise and begin to shine in that situation. Let me give you another explanation of shining. It means prevail. Somebody hashtag prevail. Until Amen. You rise up and you begin to make your presence known. My God, I'm just saying something. I just said something right there. Some of you, it's like you don't even exist. People don't know that you exist. You don't make your presence known. You are shy. You are timid. You are hiding. You do everything with small mentality, poverty mentality. You are scared. You know, it's like you don't have no God. But I come to speak to somebody. There is a God in you bigger than he that is out of you.
Amen.
God is in you. It's the time for the nations to hear your voice. It's the time for the devil to know your voice and back off your family and back off you, until Deborah could come to the place where she said, now I've been called. I'm going to arise. There was a demon keeping the people of God bound. The enemy of the army of the enemy was winning until Deborah came to place. Until she came and she made her presence known. You need to arise, but then make yourself known. Make your calling known. Make your anointing known. Make yourself known that I am a child of God. Some of you or some people, we don't even know who they are or where they belong. Because one day they're posting things of the world, the next day they are posting things of God. We cannot we cannot determine their identity. We can't determine their identity. Is somebody online hearing us this morning?
Amen.
That's why the woman of God keeps saying, arise, shine, arise, shine. She's saying, take your place, take a stand, wake up. Arise and shine is also a call for an awakening. An awakening. Can you talk about the sleeper and why the sleepers need to awake?
The Bible says, arise, awake, awake, O sleeper, for Christ is risen upon thee. You see, Christ always rise upon his people. He said, awake, O sleeper. So people are sleeping. Many people are sleeping in their prayer life. Many people are sleeping in their journey with God. Yes, sometimes it's because they have been disappointed. Sometimes it's because of what has happened to them in the church. But God is saying, wake up, wake up. It's like an alarm. An alarm that God is sounding in the atmosphere. He's saying, my light is upon my people. That is what God has been telling me. He said, his light is upon his people, but the faithlessness of his people are not catching the light because they are not believing God. They have believed the world for too long. They have believed the people for too long, telling them being a Christian is just going to church and coming back. No. If we check the whole Bible, Christians, church people were the judges. Church people were the people to set up kings and kick out kings. So that is the place God gave us. But the enemy came and manipulated us out of a place of rulership and dominion and put us on the background. But God is saying no more. He's saying, wow, come to the front line. Come, this is a time that I am going to propel you forward. He said, arise and shine and come to that place. Stop sleeping. Yes, it hurts you. Yes, it hurts like hell. But God is saying, stuff yourself up and be healed. Be healed. Many people are in a place of brokenness where they are not healed. They are still holding unforgiveness from their old pastor, ex-husband, ex-boyfriend, ex-something. Or some parents are hurt by their children. And they are saying, if there was a God, my child will not do A or B. And so they keep themselves bound up. They keep themselves in a place of sleeping. They keep themselves, and when you keep yourself in a place of sleeping, the enemy, because you give the enemy a foothold, he busts the door open, depression comes in, oppression comes in, illness comes in, then you have heart attack. Because of the bitterness, then you develop cancer. Yeah. All these things comes because you are sleeping. But God is saying, awake, awake, my child. Awake, awake, because my glory is upon you. The light of Jesus Christ of Nazareth is upon you. If the light of the King of Glory is upon you, there is my no God. Darkness that can keep you bound. There is no my human God. On earth that can keep you down. I always tell people, the only thing that limits you is you. Because God has removed the limitation. God has removed limitation. Since Wednesday, I wore a t-shirt that says no limit. Because that is what is in my spirit. That is what God keeps saying. Limitations are off. Yes. So now you have to arise and walk into destiny. You have to stop sleeping and stop making excuses.
Yes.
Many of the people is excuses. Yes, some people stay in churches that they were not supposed to stay because they know the church is not bad, but their season in that church is over. So now they have to go to the next level. It's like you keep holding yourself in elementary one until you get out of elementary one to elementary two and to 3 and 4 and 5 and 6 and whatever elementary in your country it is, you will not get your diploma. You will not proceed to your next level. So you have to wake up. If your season is over in a particular church, go to your pastor, bless them, and say, I love you. Don't live anywhere with anger. If you live in anger, go back and apologize. Tell them my season is over. I bless the house, I bless you people, and I am leaving, not because I hate you, but because my next assignment is ahead. If Apostle Paul was sitting on one place, he would not reach the people he had to reach. Every time he had to move on, Jesus had to go. The Bible said he need go to Samaria. for one woman. Where is your assignment? Why are you sleeping? Your assignment may not be the whole generation. It may be one woman who has generation in her. It may be one man who has generation. Like the man with the legion, he had 10 cities. Can you imagine that? So if you arise and shine for one person, but in that person there is 10 cities or 10 generations, or to raise the men, you have done your assignment.
Yes.
But if you keep staying in the place and waiting and keep sleeping, your purpose is not going to be fulfilled. That's and let me bust your bubbles. Until your purpose is fulfilled, you will die full and God will make you answer for it. Because there are souls attached to your name. There are people attached to your name. There are people that if you don't rise up and shine, or if you don't wake up from slumber, they will die and go to hell, and God will ask their blood on your hands. So it is a must for you to arise and shine.
Yes. I just want to add on to that. I just want to know, is anybody getting what we are saying this time? Don't sleep anymore. Wake up. The time is shorter for some people than you may think. There is an assignment upon your life. There is a call. One minute. I just got this from the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Have you received what we are just speaking right here? That the glory of God is upon you. God is upon you. When you arise and you want to put yourself in a place where God can use you, God is obligated to come over you, because he knows he cannot assign you. He cannot let you go without his glory. He cannot let you go. When Jesus told the disciples in Matthew chapter 8 to go into the world and make disciples and baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. When he told them that, then he promised them the Holy Spirit will come upon them. He gave them an assignment, but with that assignment, he knew he had to cover them and empower them by his glory, by the Holy Spirit coming upon them. Because God will not cause you to arise and he wants you to shine without him coming over you as your covering. Somebody hashtag, God is my covering.
Amen.
God is your covering. He will not let you go. He said, and when the Holy Spirit shall come upon you, you shall receive what? Power. Which means when God is calling you, there is a set power that has been assigned for you to receive as you arise. There is a power and a place of God or authority you will never attend and receive or get hold of until you decide to arise and begin to take a walk for God. Until you arise and begin to shine for God. When you begin to shine for God, God is obligated to send angels Amen. To watch over you. He's obligated to come with you and to go before you. God does not go before those who are just sitting. Because why should he go before you when you're just on your bed? If you want to see the manifestation, the power and the hand of God upon your life, if you want to go to a higher realm of operation in spiritual things, as long as you are sitting where you are sitting, as long as you are comfortable in one dimension, the old dimension is over. That's why your dreams don't come anymore. Some of you say, I used to dream, I don't dream anymore. Because you are dealing with all glory. That glory of yesterday will not work for the power that God wants to reveal through your life today. So when you decide to go higher, the glory increases to meet you there, to cover you where you are. Why will God give you 3 glasses of water when your belly can only contain 1 glass of water? When you are at the level of 1 glass of water, God does not waste anointing. God does not waste oil. You want to see signs and wonders and miracles.
sitting on your bed, praying day and night and not putting work to it is not going to cost you. If you want the sick, oh God, anoint my hands to heal the sick. What are you doing with your life? Are you going to places to meet the sick? Are you visiting the sick? Are you going to the hospital? Are you evangelizing and praying on the streets? Why will God give you healing anointing if you are not doing nothing with your life? But when you arise and begin to shine and begin to move, you will see the blessings of God overtaking you. His angels Amen. Be assigned to you, and the power of God will begin to walk through you. And through the testimonies of God, the power of God, many Amen. Will be drawn to you. So when you arise and shine, not only does God go with you or comes upon you and cover you because you need his power to do his work, but now he gives you influence.
Mm-hmm.
I know I'm preaching to somebody. He gives Amen. You influence. You will never receive influence until you rise up and begin and shine. To shine. Influence comes when you arise and shine. People will only come to the light when there is an arising and a shining. But it starts from arising. God didn't say, shine and arise. No, some of you want to serve God only when all your problems are gone. That's backwards. That's putting the cart in front of the horse. He said, first, if you want to shine, let me see you stand up. Let me see you make a move. Let me see you do something. Let me see you take a stance for something. Let me hear you praying. Let me see you fasting. Let me see you commanding your morning. Let me see you doing something. And it's not enough to do something, but do something which is right. Do the right thing and do it with the right people. If you arise and you're trying to shine and you are already connected to the wrong people, your light is going to go dim. Are you understanding me? Because God will not share his glory with another. There's a light that God wants to give to you. But if you are too quick to connect with some people, they may come and begin to take God's glory. But then God will say, no. Because you are connected to a glory thief, I can't allow you to shine the way I want you to shine. Abraham, let go of Lot.
Mm-hmm.
Some of you are carrying Lot around. You are dragging people that God never asked you to drag them along in your journey. You are connected to a wrong apostle, wrong prophet, wrong teacher, wrong pastors, wrong intercessors, wrong prayer warriors, wrong friends, wrong environment. That's why your light feel like, okay, I want to shine, but I don't see the light. Because your connection, the place that God connects you to shine, matters. Matters. Some people in your life are a veil. So in this season where God is calling us to arise and shine, you must deal with the veils in your life. You must deal with the veils in your life. So when she keeps saying, arise and shine, there are so many dimensions that we all need to understand. That first, Deborah arose. She stood up. And God said, get up from your place. Take up your bed and walk. Take up your bed and walk. I want you to talk about, because I just talked about the veil in your time of shining, the Lot and concept with Abraham. Can you warn the people the danger of connecting to the wrong thing in this season?
Amen. The danger of connecting, since Lot was not a bad person. If you check out the life of Lot, if you check out the life of Abraham, they say Lot was flourishing. But it came a moment that they could no longer walk together. How can two walk together except they agree? So, and what does Lot mean? Lot means a veil. Lot means the one that is covering. As much as he was being blessed because he was connected to Abraham, because Abraham carried him along, because God from the beginning did not ask him to take Lot along. He took him along. God allowed him to be blessed because he's connected to his son. But it came a time that God said, now I need to take you to the next level. And for me to take you to the next level, the veil that has been covering you for not having a vision, got to go. It's your family, it's your nephew. You love, Lord was a family. He wasn't just a pastor. He wasn't just a girlfriend. He was blood. But this is God. When a veil is covering you, it doesn't matter to God if that veil is blood. God will still tell you, get that veil out of your way. Don't kill them. Let them choose.
Yes.
I am going to go to B, and you are going to go to A. Or you are going to go to A, I go to B. Whatever way that you are going to choose, I will choose the latter. So in this season, it is important to identify the veil in your life.
Yes.
Who are the people who are veiling you? The veil can come in many ways. Your ear gates is exposed to people calling you continuously. If I have to talk to everybody who calls me through the messenger, I don't really care which title is front of their name. I don't need to talk to you. So you have to come to a place where you said, I bless you, but please don't call me. Because the moment they call you, they block your ears. And then the next veil can be a sight. The moment Lot leave, God told Abraham, lift up your eyes. Do you see the stars? How many stars are above you that you are not seeing? Can you imagine? Stars is light. One star, when it falls to the earth, it can cover the whole earth. One star. And Abraham had countless stars. How many stars are above your head that is veiled? That because there is a person in your life and it is veiled and you cannot see the star. It is important to remove the veil. First, you need to identify the veil.
Yes.
Who is that person in your life? Who is that connection? What is that situation? You need to get discernment. Discern to know what God is saying. Some of us, because your ear gate is so blocked and so full of everybody but God, you cannot even hear God when he's even shouting with a trumpet. There is something ahead of you, like Balaam. He could not even see the angel because his sight was blinded by a veil of disobedience. So you need to identify the veil in your life. So many people, there is a lock of wood in front of their eyes. Need to identify, because you watch everything that is ungodly. You decide to watch... I don't know the movies the children watch. There are so many demonic movies. If you are not watching it to study, let it go. Because I promise you, those movies open a realm in the demonic kingdom. And if you are not ready to battle those, keep that demon, stay off those movies. And Twilight, Vampire in Brooklyn. Okay, those are all movies. I don't know the new ones. But avoid, and those are veils. Your mind, what books are you reading?
Yes.
What are the books you are reading? And some people read horoscope. They are Christians. You are putting a veil before you.
Yes.
Some people still believe if I go on the internet and I do one of these things that they do, the people behind these things are psychics.
Wow.
Telling you your future. Those are veils. How many children will you have? How many people will come in your house? When will you get married? How will your child look like? All those things are veiled. The people behind those channels are psychic. And these are demonic portals, veil, blocking you from sin. So it is important to identify what is a veil in your life. Your own disobedience can be a veil. Your laziness can be a veil. You are lazy.
Wow.
When it is raining, you say, I'm not going to church. When the sun is shining, I'm not going to church because I need to go to the beach. When it's snowing, it's too cold. You are just being lazy. You put a veil. One of the biggest things in the kingdom of God today is servanthood. Many people want to shine, but they refuse to serve. Let me tell you, until you become a servant, you can never be anybody's leader. Jesus said, who wants to be a leader, let him first be a servant.
Yes.
There many of us want to sit on the fore row, but you don't know how to sit on the back row. So you need to learn to serve. Sometimes, maybe the person that is leading your ministry is maybe 10, 15 years younger than you, and you are looking at them down. There is ranking in their spirit. They can be 2 years old, but the anointing of God upon their life is above yours. When you serve them, God will do supernatural things for you and open doors for you. Those are also veils. Servanthood, humbleness, obedience. You say you are not coming to church today, you lie. Oh, I'm not feeling well. You decree and declare sickness. And when sickness comes upon you, you call the same pastor or apostle to pray for you. You decree sickness over your own self. So you brought the veil in. So identify the little veils that are in your life. Stop watching pornography. Stop masturbating. Especially masturbation is a highly demonic portal. It brings demons as legions. And it's not only for men. I know that thing they say is only for men. Women do it. So avoid it. These are demonic veils. And God himself cannot come into filth. Identify the veils in your life. And you will see.
Hallelujah. Wow, powerful. So when we are talking about arising and shine, there is also work for us, all of us, to do.
Amen.
We are not here talking because we have everything intact. We are all students in the hand of God. Is somebody with me? Give me 1 minute, please. We are all students in the hand of God. We are all in process. So this word is for me, it's for you, it's for her, it's for all of us and those who will watch later. Hallelujah. When you have to arise and shine, there has to be a decision. A decision to change. You can't be trying to stand up and shining and you want to hold on to the same old things. Mm-hmm. There's a work that comes in place before you get to that place of rulership. So she's been talking about things not to do. Things that can hinder your way. Number one, you must start with prayer, fasting, dedication, going back into the word. Some people, maybe not you online, have to go back to their shelf, pick up their Bible, dust it off, and start reading again. That's the thing you have to do as one who is called to arise and shine. Are you hearing me? You have to do something. You have to move. You have to put in the work, the action. If not, you are not going nowhere. You can be praying, fasting, but the actions, the things, the little take those steps. If you say you want to build a house, you cannot build a house without buying the cement, the sand, you know, doing some things. Are you hearing me? You can't. So you need to put the proper work in. 1 minute, please. Prophetess, you need to go out and come back. Go out, Facebook, come back. You understand? You need to put in the work, practical steps to take. You need, if you have not been going to a church or to the right church, your prayer has to be that God brings you to the right place. Because until you are rightly planted, according to Psalms 92, those who are planted in the house of God shall flourish even in their old age. Are you hearing me? So you want to arise and shine, you need to begin to look for the right place to be planted. Look for the right covering. Look for the right things that will help you to grow. because you need that spiritual support and guidance as you grow and move forward. You don't just wake up, oh, I rise and shine, and you get out of bed and you shine. There is a process. Even Jesus Christ, who came to reign, he wasn't born in the manger and the same day he began to shine. Jesus went through process towards his ministry, towards his place to shine. You understand? So there is always a beginning point, and there is process, and there is the ending point. So what are you doing now in your life to change? There must be some things, and the friends you have, when you are in your season to arise and shine, you can't keep the same old friends. You can't keep the same old people. You cannot. Sometimes to arise and shine, you need to dress differently. When Joseph was called to become the governor, you know, the prime minister, he didn't, the Bible says he woke up, he arose, and he combed his hair. Amen. He changed his shirt. He did something for his new position. People say, come as you are. That's true. When you come to God, come as you are. That's for unbelievers who are coming new to Christ. But those who have been in Christ, you can't stay as you are. As God is upgrading you, you need to change some things. Your mindset needs to change. Is somebody with me? It's just like, for example, you are a single man or a single woman, and you normally speak to other singles and you feel free. When you begin to date somebody in your new season, you begin to avoid all those other relationships or contact with people, because it's your new season that you are engaging in building something concrete. You are respecting your moment with that person. You need to have integrity how you hold that relationship. You need to have respect, and you need to build it well, lest it falls apart. So there are practical things you need to do to change. You need to change the way you talk. You can't be talking like a street woman, street man from the ghetto, and you want to be the director of a company. When you are going for an interview in a prestigious position, there is a way you present yourself. Arise and shine takes a lot of different things. Mm-hmm. There are different dimensions you need to think of. Change your contact, how you, the people you hang around, the way you call them. When you are arising and shine, like she said, you can't be everybody telephone mate. They have problem with their cat, they call you and you give them time. They have problem with their dog, they call you and you give them time. They have problem with their husband. No, you need to put some limitations. You need to put some guidelines. Why? Because now you have investment in the right places. You have time to pray. You have time to worship. You have time to meditate. You have time to do your planning. You have time to call your important. Now, for example, myself, I have a lot of spiritual daughters and sons all over the world. And they are increasing daily. So I can't be speaking with my friends and family the way I used to speak with them, because my focus now is building my ministry. That's my focus. Is family important? Yes. But there is time for everything. And if they really care about me, they will understand my season and support me instead of complaining and trying to tear it down. Because if I succeed, I go up. My family goes up. All of us can be broke and all of us can be jacked up. Somebody needs to arise and shine in the family, and that needs to be you. So you can't let crushes, I call them octopus and crabs. You know, crab spirit, they want to pull you down. They want to grab on you. They are always trying to get you. Some people in your family have crab spirit. Mm-hmm. And octopus, they just want to swap you in their octopus, you know, under them. You need to break those things in the spirit and let them leave you. They need to cut you loose. You need to run for your life like Joseph. Potiphar's wife was trying to hold him, but he ran away. Some people are like that. And you understand, when you're trying to run for your life, for what God has for you, they want to grab you. Joseph left his shirt behind. He said, woman, if you want to take my shirt, but I'm running for my life. I'm running for my destiny. I'm not going to be here and remain in all the same place with you, sin with you, fornicate with you, and break the law with you. I'm moving forward.
Amen.
So when you are arising and shine, you have to be radical. You have to have boldness and tenacity to let go of some people. Leave them behind. If they can't come to the place where you are at, then leave them there. You go ahead. If they are ready, they will run and catch you where you are at. Somebody needs to be the forerunner. Somebody needs to be the captain. Somebody needs to be the boss in this camp. And you're going to be the boss to say, you know what? All of us can be down. Some of us need to be up. And I'm going to walk up and encourage you, motivate you to come up as well. So you have to change. Women especially, you have to change the way you address things. You can't be trying to say, oh, God has called me as a prophetess. And you are on Facebook with your breasts all over the place. Hello? You can't. You need to package yourself well. We women of God, daughters of Zion, we need to be decent.
Mm-hmm.
Are you hearing me? Be beautiful, be cute, be powerful, but be a woman who is decent. The Bible says she is giving strength and dignity. You need to have strength, but have some dignity about you. If you used to shout on the street, talking anyhow, like, you know, you need to tone your voice down. Let your words be seasoned with salt. Calm down yourself. If you used to call people on Facebook and insult them, no, don't do it no more. Because God is packaging you as one of his son. You know, he's light for the world to see that he's a God of glory. Is somebody out there hearing what we are saying today? So you have,
amen,
you have to change. Transformation. Somebody just hashtag transformation. Transformation. It's time for transformation. In your time of arising and shining, you are going from one dimension, from one season, one place, to a new place. So you must be transformed. By the renewing of your mind, you have to change your mind. I used to be so angry, but now I changed my mind. I will be patient. Because why? When you work with people, when you are arising and shining, God will cause you to work with people. And part of working with people is to have a lot of patience. Your grace level needs to go to a new level. Your level of mercy has to go to a new level. I work with a lot of people. She works with a lot of people. And we have to deal with all kinds of people. So what do? You pray for patience. If you are a harsh person, you need to learn to become calmer. Don't be harsh and just rebuke people. You don't have the right to rebuke everybody. You are not everybody's pastor or apostle. No, keep your mouth to yourself until God assigns you. If not, when you are trying to arise and shine, you are going to crash. Because you're going to invite a lot of unnecessary warfare to yourself. You are going to attract negative attention to yourself. Mm-hmm. And that's not what you want. You don't want negative attention to yourself. How can you be a light and the light only produce negativity? That's not a good light. Mm-hmm. You want your light to come into a light of positive things. That people can look at you and say, truly, you are the child of God Almighty.
Amen.
And she touched on being a servant before you can become a leader. In your time of arising and shining, you must avoid pride. Can you talk about, Prophet Sally, the danger of pride?
Pride is very, very, I call pride a satanic spirit. Why do I choose to call pride a satanic spirit? Because pride was what caused Satan to desire the throne of God. When pride comes into a man or a woman of God, you start desiring things that you are not yet there. Remember, Satan was a beautiful angel created by God. The Bible says he had even music on his wings. That's how beautiful he was. In charge of all the heavenly choirs, standing beside God's throne, yet he wasn't satisfied. He started longing for something that was not meant for him. That is what pride does. When pride comes into you, you start seeing your leader, or it can be a child, it can be whatever, you start seeing the person that is ahead of you as, I have that gift. They have mentored me long enough. I can do better than they can do. I can speak better than they can speak. I know the scripture from Genesis to Revelation. I can quote all the scriptures and all those things. They are good things. But there is a process. But the moment you allow pride to rule you, the Bible says, pride comes before a fall. So when pride comes in you, I can guarantee you, you are about to fall and crash.
Yes.
And the higher you have gone, that is how hard you are going to fall. Let me take a story building for example. If you have grown up to 10 stories and you are falling down, my God, if care is not taken, they cannot pick you up alive spiritually, because you allow pride to possess a place that was already given to you. Say that again. He could stand in the presence of God. He was the person of a throne room. He enjoyed the choir given to him to train the choir. For example, I am the head of the Women for Women After God's Heart International Intercessory Ministries, handed to me over by Apostle Claire. Then all of a sudden, pride comes in because I am heading one ministry. And I start saying, yes, I can do better because now I have read books. I have read Bible. I have done this. I have done that. That is where I am going to fall. That is where fall is going to come in, because pride just came in to destroy a position you already have. Many people don't understand that pride is a veil that blinds you from something is already yours.
Wow.
It is already, he was already a leader. Not just a leader, a throne room leader to the heavenly angels. He was one of God's greatest armor bearer, let me put it like that. So he already has a position of high ranking. So in a place like that, somebody will not desire anything else. Satisfaction will stop you from being prideful. Be content with the position given to you.
My God.
Most people are not content with the position. They always envy that of somebody else. And that starts bringing a particular thing in their spirit. And then pride comes in. And they start saying, yes, I can do better than this. I can do better than that. You can do better than nobody. Do better in where you are. If you know you are this powerful, the people that they have placed under you, build them up to take over the nation.
Yes.
I am crazy about the children ministry. My priority is to build the children into world leaders.
Yes.
You can say, oh, it's children ministry. You can say, oh, it's women ministry. Women are called to give birth to kings.
Yes.
So in my mind, pride will not come in. Why? Because I know my purpose.
Yes.
There are broken women. So if I can take my position and go down on my knees and God reveal their purpose, and I build them up in their purpose, they can go up and become better. They can go up and raise up kings. They can go up and do mighty things. But if my view is limited, all I see is a position of Apostle Claire that she travels, I miss the position of God upon my life. And therefore, the pride will kill me. So whatever you are doing, I don't know if they give you to clean the toilet. If you listen to the testimony of Juanita Bynum, people say, oh, she's a powerful prophetess. She started by cleaning the toilet.
Wow.
She was a prophetess. When the pastor told her, go and clean the toilet.
Yes.
In the beginning, she said, what? I'm a prophet. But God said, go and clean. As you are cleaning the toilet, you are cleaning nations. As you are cleaning the toilet, you are cleaning lives. What is a position given to you in the church? Don't allow pride to kill you from the place that is has already been given to you. You said, I've been called to reach the nation. They say, go and share a flyer on the street. You say, it's cold. The sun is too much. I want to go to the beach. I want to do A, B, C, and D. But you want to reach the nations.
Yes.
Or you said, me, go on the streets.
Wow.
I'm big. I am the director of, I don't know. But in the kingdom of God, nobody is a director. You want to reach the world. Go on the streets. That's the first commission of Jesus, by the way. Go ye into the world. He didn't say only the evangelist should go. He said, go all. So these things, you can take it so simple, but those are things that portray your pridefulness. They can say, come on a prayer meeting unannounced. I was busy here. Apostle Claire just come and said, we are going live on Facebook. I was like, oh Lord, I'm just getting out of my bed. I had to comb my hair. I have to get my clothes on. I have to fix the setup. So it's when they say go, you go. I know some people like, today I'm home, and you will make all kind of excuse. I wanted to iron. I wanted to sit with Kieran and do things. I had a different planning. Did she just mess up my plan? Of course not. Because this is the agenda of God. So when you have pride, you don't see the agenda of God. You start thinking of me, 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 and me. If I could but ascend to the throne of God, that was a statement of Satan, I. So it's all about the I in you. Pride is a killer. It's a satanic spirit that kills. And Satan has three agenda: to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Pride comes and does the same thing. It steals the position that has already been given to you. Because something cannot be stolen to you from you when it was not given to you. It kills your destiny. And it destroys your next level. That is the agenda of pride. It's a highly satanic spirit. So you have to be careful that you don't allow Satan and his anointing, let me put it like that, be upon you.
Powerful. Hallelujah. Amen. I just want to touch on what you said. You said a lot of powerful things. You know, I'm a mother in the house, and my calling is to also train people. Sometimes we have conferences out of the city of Rotterdam, and we go to a different place. Or we can have something doing in Rotterdam, in Zion, and we don't have too many people yet, but we have a handful of them. And I will see that some things are not done. And I will just say, can somebody arrange that? Sometimes it's food. I also, can somebody set the table? I won't call a particular person's name, but I will say it loud enough for everybody around me to hear it. And I've marked a few people who will never move.
Mm-hmm.
But what people don't understand, that every leader has the potential to promote you or to demote you or to leave you where you are at. No leader set by God is foolish. The leaders know those who really are servants. They can say with your mouth. Leaders know those who really honor them and respect them and really just want to serve. Leaders know those who just want to steal their anointing by the laying of hands and speaking to them, but they don't want to do anything. I know everybody in my ministry. I know those who are really servants and those who are walking with pride. And I've marked them. And those kind of people, I can do little things with them, but I can never, if I have the grace even to commend them or recommend them, I will never. Because I see their action in the house. When I say, can you people just do this? I see those people, I can say sometimes right near to their ear, they won't even move. Or can somebody get me a glass of water? Can somebody make sure that these people here have soup? Some people wouldn't even move. And I know them. And one of the problems we have in the kingdom is this. Some people think they are too big. Oh, I am already 60. I am 90. I am 100. And you may be 30. You are the leader, but I'm not going to listen to you. You are making a big mistake. A leader of God is never small. No matter how young they are, she said it before. You can be 90 years old and God puts you under a leader of 10 years old. You are to submit, honor them, love them. Not by the natural age. Paul said this. I think it is in the book of, let me see, I think it's either 2 Corinthians 5 or 2 Corinthians or 1 Corinthians. Let me check it out. Paul says something very important. Let me read it to you, because a lot of people are missing their season and destroying their lives and losing opportunities because of attitude and because some people also culture, like black culture. Black people are so keen on age and all of those things, and it's killing a lot of black people, especially black women. They will be with a leader who is maybe 10 years younger than them because they want to begin to treat them like their daughter. No, they're not your daughter. They are your spiritual mother. If God places you under them, they may be the age of your daughter or your children, but you don't walk with them with familiarity. You don't walk with them by natural understanding, but you walk with them by spiritual understanding and spiritual authority and spiritual setting. Paul says something I would like to read. Just give me 1 minute to search it out. Amen?
Amen.
Because in the season that God is causing us to arise and shine, if we don't get all these things in place and intact, we are going to mess up what God wants to do. Know that every leader, no matter how big or small, they have the potential, because you don't know who they are connected to. They may not have the money you need, but they may know someone who has the money you need for your business.
That's right.
And if your character is right, they can introduce you. They can talk to the person about you like, oh, I have a spiritual daughter, or a spiritual son, or a mentee, can you help them? But when your character and attitude is messed up, because you can't be, for example, let me take myself, you can't be a rude mentee, spiritual daughter or son to me, and you think I will trust you enough to connect with somebody. You're going to mess up your reputation, that of the kingdom, and my reputation, so therefore I can never introduce somebody with bad attitude or recommend them to any of my connections. I can never do that. Because if you are acting rude to me or disrespectful or prideful, when I say, can somebody do something? Somebody will be turning around. They don't move. And then the ones who are always serving are the same ones who are always serving. Sometimes it's to buy something in the church. Just as simple like, can everybody bring food? There are always a particular of people bringing food and things, and some are just taking. That's a spirit right there. You are not generous. You don't have to feed the family. You don't give into the family, but you take out of the family. It's a spirit, you know? So we need to put all of those things intact and say, okay, what do I want to do with myself in this season? How can I do those things? How can I ask? How can I help? Sometimes I will be saying that we need certain things. Very few people will come to me, for example, in my ministry and say, Apostle, how can we help? A true person, a servant, a child of God, a disciple, a mentee, a son and a daughter will see the need and ask a question. Pastor, prophet, apostle, how can I help? But too many people are busy building their own paradise and their own kingdom. And the one that God has given them to build together with their man or woman of God to support and be trained, they are not doing it. Everybody trying to get their own recognition. Everybody trying to get their own title. Is somebody getting what I'm saying? Hallelujah. Let me try to read what Paul was saying here. So let's go to 2 Corinthians. Chapter 5, verse 16. This is Sunday, so we're supposed to have our Bibles. Amen. 2 Corinthians, chapter 5, verse 16. Let's go there, please. I'm looking like this because I'm looking at my Bible. If you are there, can somebody write it down for us? 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 16. I want to show you something powerful that I hope will help revolutionize your life, change your life, and transform your life, how you deal in your season, where you're supposed to be humble. And this message is a message we all have to carry upon our hearts forever. I am submitted to leadership and people who are younger than me. Understand me? They are younger than me. I'm far older in age, natural age, than them. But they are far older than me spiritually. And you understand? Their anointing, their grace, their level, the authority God has placed upon them, the dimension from which they function is far above mine. And I honor and respect them for that. I can pray. I was struggling with something for a while. I was really struggling. I've prayed years after years, and it wasn't leaving me. I am the one who casts out demons from people. I prophesy, things come to pass. God used me to raise the dead. God used me to heal the sick. But I couldn't pray that problem out of my own life. I was watching my apostle, my spiritual father. You know, I was watching him, and then he began to prophesy. He began to speak healing over that situation I was dealing with. I stretched out my hand to the screen. I said, I receive it. Because this is a father. He's my covering. When I went under his anointing and humbled myself and said, I receive it. Till today, I have been healed from that issue. Instant healing during his broadcast. Let me tell you a secret. It's not a secret. My apostle, age-wise, Apostle Ryan, he's a bit younger than me. I think I'm like 1 or 2 years older than him. So, should I be now like, oh, I am big sister? No, I am small sister because I function under the realms of the spirit. Biblical understanding. He's like my big, he's my father. Apostle Ryan is not my friend. He's not my brother. He's my father. So I will never call him, hey, sis, hey, bro, how are you? No, I call him Papa. I call him Papa Ryan. I will never address like, hey, how are you? Hi, hey, darling. Hi, sweetheart. It's rude. It's wrong. It's wrong. So let me see something. Are we there? Ephesians, 2 Corinthians 5, Amen. Verse 16. Amen. Let me read it. It says, so we have stopped evaluating others from a human point of view. Mm-hmm. We have stopped. Prophetess, can you open King James Version? We are going to read it from two different versions. I am reading now from the New Living Translation. It says, so we have stopped evaluating others from a human point of view. At one time, we thought of Christ merely from a human point of view. How differently we know him now.
Amen.
So at one point, Paul was speaking to the people, to the Corinthians. He said, we have come to a level by spiritual understanding to stop. Let her read it first in King James Version.
Therefore, henceforth know we no man according to the flesh. Yea, though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now henceforth we know him no more. We know him so no more.
You see? So before the new Christ, according to the flesh, it means according to human understanding, according to his natural being, according to his natural form, his natural position, his natural age, his natural function. That's how the new Christ before. But then they came to pass, they received a revelation. But they said, from now on, something has shifted. Something has shifted. Something has changed. We no longer know him from the human point of view. We no longer know him by the views of the flesh, but we know him now by the views of the spirit. Because in the flesh, Jesus was another man walking the planet Earth. Is somebody hearing me?
Amen.
In the flesh, he was Christ, the Nazarian. He was a carpenter's boy. He was, he was this guy that caused confusion in the city when he was preaching. In the flesh, he was 33 years old. Are you understanding me? In the flesh, he was a brother. He was a son, the child of Mary, in the flesh. But in the spirit, he was the Lord of lords over Mary. My God. Somebody getting this? That's why when Mary came to him in the flesh, he said, woman. That was a rebuke, actually. Hey, don't get it twisted. Because Mary was going to Jesus as her son, telling her that the wine is over, with motherly authority. With the authority of the mother, thinking, I am the mother, so now I can just go to his ministry where he's preaching and just tell him to do whatever, and he will jump. And Jesus switched. He said, hey, woman. He didn't call Mary mother. Did Jesus call Mary mother? He didn't. He didn't call Mary mother. He said, woman. If it was in our day now, the mothers would take offense. How can my son just be calling me woman? No, Jesus was telling Mary, don't get your flesh twisted with who I am. In the flesh, you are my mother. I'm about my father's business. You don't come and interrupt. You don't come and disturb. You don't come and begin to cause conflict and address me any kind of way. Is somebody with me? That's what Jesus, without saying many words, was trying to teach his mother Mary. So that then Paul is telling us in 2 Corinthians 16, 5, verse 15 and 16, he's telling us that before we used to know Jesus from that dimension, but now we know him as Lord. We know him as God. We know him as Messiah. We know him as the resurrected one. We know him in a different way in the spirit. He said, and by the way, it's not only Christ. He said, we no longer know any man according to flesh. We judge people. We know them. We value them according to spirit. My God. According to spirit. If you don't know your apostle, your prophet, your pastor, your teacher, your intercessors according to spirit, you will take them for granted. You'll be talking, oh, this is my son. Yeah, my son is just a pastor. No, that's your pastor. Your son can be your child, your natural child you gave birth to. But in his ranking, he's your pastor. So you cannot go into where he's ministering amongst his friends and just address him or treat him any kind of a way. Even if you knew him before as son, the rebellious son who you used to wash, you put Vaseline on his face, you comb his head, but now there is a shift. There is a shift. When your son calls you, say, come and bow down. Don't be like, I am your mother, why should I bow down in front of you? That's disobedient to the spirit of God and the anointing and the mantle of God upon him. You go and bow down. When your son, he can be your son. You gave birth to him. He's preaching and said, can you get me water? You are the mother. At that moment, he's under that umbrella in a different realm, in a different place. At that moment, he's not even seeing you as a mother. He's moving in course, in function, and he asks you for water, and you're taking an issue. Some people will go home, son, why did you address me like that? You just told me, give me water. But he was in course. He was moving from the pulpit, and he needed water, and you were there, and he just said, give me water. That the spirit of authority upon him spoke, and then you take offense. It can be that with your friend. Your friend that you used to know, it can be a man friend, a lady friend. Your friend transits from one position to a different position. And your friend begins to push away from you because you are too familiar with your friend. There are people I used to know from the past, and when they meet me, they want to operate with me the same old way, and I'm just sitting like this. Looking at them, and they think I'm angry. I'm not angry. The old clear reveal died, and the new one has resurrected with a new mindset, with a new anointing. I have risen, arise and shine. There is a different place I am walking, a different line I am taking. So you can't come to me with the same old talk. Hey, high five. And you think I'm going to be high fiving with you the same old way? No. Or I am in the midst of ministry and somebody thinks they can just come to me and blah, blah, blah. I'm going to look at them like seriously. And that's why we have armor bearers. I was so blessed yesterday. I went to a conference, Deborah Arise, of my beloved friend, Apostle Paulette. So she was in a moment when she was ministering so powerfully. And she fell on the floor and she began to cry out to God for the nations. She always travels with her armor bearers, like four of them at least. So when she fell on the floor, the armor bearers were standing a little bit away from her. Immediately, one of them ran and came and stood nearer to her. Then a woman of God, who is a prophetess, just came from her seat and wanted to go and lay hands on Apostle Paulette and hold her. And she had a covering cloth in her hands to cover Apostle Paulette. The way her armor bearers ran, I mean, they didn't walk. And the other one blocked the prophetess with her shoulder. Are you hearing me? The other one blocked the prophetess with her shoulder and they pushed the covering cloth from the other prophetess' hand not to touch Apostle Paulette. She was shielded by her armor bearers. I was so impressed. I said, God, give me that. They did not allow anybody to touch the apostle because, number one, the covering and cloth of the prophetess, you don't know where it comes from. You can't be covering my apostle or my, you know, we are the shield. Spiritual children should be the shield to their spiritual parents. But there needs to be proper training. You understand me? So that they shielded her and then they use her own covering cloth. They carry a specific cloth that is if the woman of God is slain or wherever, they don't allow any other cloth to touch her body. Only that which has been prepared for her. They don't carry the general cloth that every Jack and Jill, not that the people of God are bad, but we need to be sensitive in the spirit. Women and men of God are more sensitive and more open to attack when they are preaching and after they've just finished preaching. Their guard is down. So who takes care of them? The sons and daughters that have been prepared to watch over them. Like yesterday, I was just there on my knees because the anointing was so high. I went on my knees. I went alone anyway. All of a sudden, I felt somebody's hand on my head and on my belly. I was like, who is this? Because people don't know how to respect your personal space. I don't like nobody laying hands on me, nobody touching my belly. If you are not ordained to be like my apostle, my spiritual mother, or somebody I trust. So if you are a child and you are there, or a servant, you know that you are with your spiritual mother, you cannot wait to have a position before you run to the place of protection. Mm-hmm. I just said something. You cannot wait to be in a place of position before you can take your place in the place of protection. So we have to understand all those kind of things. And now people can be so familiar. The woman, the prophetess who ran to come and touch Apostle Paulette, she's an elderly woman here in Holland. People know her. She's big and all of that. But Apostle Paulette is higher in rank. But she was just thinking, oh, I'm known. And in this season, that prophetess who was running to touch Apostle Paulette, I know personally, she's in a place of drought, dryness, Ichabod. The glory has departed from her. So how dare you want to go and touch somebody who is walking in the higher glory than you? What do you want to impart in them? They need to impart in you. But the woman now, the prophetess, she was walking in familiar spirit. She was thinking, oh, this and that. And she was walking in the flesh. She looked at Apostle Paulette to be younger, not that old in ministry as compared to her. So she thought she had the right to go and lay hands on her. But thank God for great armor bearers that have been trained and their tenacity was, I was like, wow, I've never seen such a thing. They ran and they blocked every army like you would think that they were protecting Michael Jackson. They put their hand like that and they turned the woman and they pushed the cloth. Don't touch our apostle. Don't touch. We don't know you. We don't know your anointing. We don't know where your cloth came from. Do not touch. And that's what we are dealing with the spirit of familiarity. That mm-hmm. people think they can just look at you and they want to approach you the same way they used to approach you. But Paul say, we know no man according to flesh. If that prophetess would have been discerning, she would have known that her action would backfire on her.
Mm-hmm.
But she wasn't in the spirit. She was looking everything in the flesh. And she didn't understand that these armor bearers were trained. She saw them there. Everybody saw them. They are always one step away from their apostle. They don't leave her too far. They are always like watching, and they always keep contact, eye contact with each other. They don't lose sight with each other. They're always making sense like, hey, watch this. Somebody's coming. She's going to fall. Do this. Bring her slippers. You know? And that's the spirit that God is calling us.
Amen.
Because when you arise in that kind of a position and you serve from that level, God will raise up people to serve you. Amen. Don't be familiar with the anointing. Don't be chatting, hey, how are you, Claire? High five. No. No, 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 no. When you do that already, the anointing you don't honor can never be imparted to you. You block the flow. Can you talk about honoring the anointing, prophetess? Then we need to round up soon.
Honoring the anointing is very, very important. I like Elisha's story, because it shows, even though Elisha had a school of the prophets, the prophets were every step away with him. Because if you read the story, in every place he goes, they always said, did you know? Did you know? They know he was an armor bearer. Did you know? Meaning every city Elijah went with Elisha, they followed. But Elisha was not following to watch. He was following because he honors the man of God. And he understood what he carries. They understood that he was about to leave.
Yes.
But they did not understand the true meaning of impartation.
Yes.
They did not see that he was going to be impacting or imparting anyone. They did not honor the anointing upon his life. They just know he was there with them. He was maybe their teacher, their prophet. But now, you know, anyway, he's leaving. So who cares? They didn't understand that if you follow him till the end, the spirit of sonship, a son honors his mother or father. When you don't honor the anointing of your mom or your dad, I don't care who you are, it's not going to come to you. Because even like spiritual children or natural children, that they have a mom like a prophet or an apostle or a pastor, there comes a time in the anointing of the mother's, natural mother's life, that when they come in their presence, they come as, I'm coming to talk to my apostle, or I'm coming to talk to my pastor. There is a time that you come to talk like you're coming to talk to your mom. Let me give you an example. I was praying, I have a lot of anointing oil because I share it. I was praying over the anointing oil. I have prayed and prophesied and spoken over this oil for more than weeks. My son is watching me. I didn't know all the time what I'm doing. He's watching. I'm talking about the spirit of sonship now to honor the anointing. The moment I lift up the anointing, because he knew the prophecy over the anointing, I took it that I'm about to take it. He asked me, Mom, what are you going to do? I said, I'm going to take it outside. So I spray it upon my hand. So I sprayed on my hand. I was praying for myself. So before I leave, he came and touched my hand. He said, whatever you are prophesying, come upon me. At that time, he was 12 or 13. But he understands the honor you give to an anointing. I am his natural mom. But in that moment, he saw a prophet. And he refused the anointing to leave his presence to go to somebody else without him receiving first. So he honored the anointing. And in that moment, I was moved to speak over his life. And I was not speaking as his mom at that moment. I was speaking as a prophet of God. So when you honor the anointing, Whether it's your natural mom or your spiritual mom, you honor the anointing upon their life. You receive the virtue. The woman of the with the issue of blood showed us that. Everybody, there were thousands and thousands of people around Jesus. This is Jesus. But because she honored the anointing, she went. And you hear Jesus' disciples said, you said people, somebody pressed on you with all these people around you. He said, yes, somebody touched me because virtue left me.
Yes.
Why did virtue leave your father or your mother if you don't honor it?
Yes.
Remember, many people were touching God. There are many people who comes into the presence of the man or woman of God and go home jacked up. Why? Because of the spirit of familiarity. You didn't honor the anointing. Maybe their natural sister, your mother, your whatever, or your friend or somebody you knew, you saw them growing up. And you are in the midst of everybody. But you are sitting like, bring it on. I know you. We used to eat my hamburgers together. We used to cook together. But you don't know there is a shift. And because you are sitting there lay back, whatever is being poured into the atmosphere, you will never receive it. It's not a curse, but because you are not respecting the mantle and the oracle of God, whatever God is pouring out in the atmosphere will not come to you.
Yes.
The prophets, they follow Elijah. But one person received the mantle. Yes. He received a double portion. Why? Because he honored. He said, my father, my father. They said, do you know your master? He said, I know my father. So he said, my father, a sonship, when you honor, because parents and children honor their parents. The moment you become a son or a daughter, you automatically receive an impartation, because the moment you come to a place of sonship, I don't care if you are 6 million years old and the person is 2 years old. But when you come to that place of the realm of the spirit, that you are seeing them in the spirit, you will receive an impartation. But until you
Let me say something. She just said something very powerful. Just hold that thought. You are going to continue. Until you can see your man or a woman as a father or a mother, you can never receive the anointing that belongs to sons and daughters.
Mm-hmm.
That's a powerful point. Until you can see your man of God or your woman of God as a mother and a father in the spirit, you will never be able to open the dimension of their impartation upon your life. The mantle will never fall on you as long as you still see them as your sister, your brother, your uncle, your auntie. The day you make the switch that this is my mother, this is my father, that day you open something so powerful in the realms of the spirit and you receive an impartation. Did that make sense to anybody? She said something powerful. I just wanted to lay it out. So for those of you who are still familiar, she's just a pastor. You are blocking your own. They can lay hands on you, but the doors are shut. Because even Jesus said to the woman, it is not meet to give the bread of the children. The anointing, the mantle upon your man and the woman of God belongs to the children. Jesus was using the same principle. He said, it is not meet to give the bread of the children to dogs. It means it is not good to give that which belongs to the children to outsiders.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus was talking with the disciples outside, speaking in parables. The disciples asked him, Master, why do you speak to them in parables? He said, I speak to you in clear language that you can understand because you are part of me. You are children. So I don't talk to you in parables. I talk to you with clear language and knowledge and understanding. But to outsiders,
I talk to them, but the dimension of what I give them is different from what I give sons and daughters. This is too good. It's different from what I give sons and daughters. So if you make yourself not to be son or daughter, you shut yourself out of some benefits that comes from the spiritual realm. Prophetess, continue.
You know, exactly as I'm supposed to say, you shut yourself from the spiritual realm. Why? Because we don't feed everybody's children. As much as I love children, I will take care of mine first. So whatever your anointed, your man of God is having, if you don't see them in the spirit realm as your dad or your mom, I will tell you to take a step back or pray and wait until God reveals to you.
Yes.
Because many of us are missing the blessings of God because we are failing to see the mantle of the man and woman of God God has placed over their lives. I was talking to somebody, like, yeah, you and Apostle Claire are family. I say, yeah, but do you know what I see? I say, connecting to her gave me a mantle of resurrection power. I said, because she raised the dead. She heals the sick. I said, so when I'm connecting to her, I'm connecting like a daughter. I might be the elder sister, but I'm connecting as a daughter. Therefore, I receive.
Yes.
You become humble in the place of a child that you receive impartation. And many of us want to function and you don't want to honor. There is a friend who called me and was talking, he's going through a situation. And so I asked her the question. I said, do you want the prophet to speak or do you want Sally to speak? I said, there's a great difference. I said, because I'm talking and you keep breaking me. So which one do you want me to function now? I said, I will do both. He said, no. Then she backed off. I said, now please speak like a prophet. And I spoke and the situation was changed. If she wanted me to speak like a sister, we would laugh and have fun. And I will go. I will give you a sisterly advice. But if you allow me to wear my mantle and you honor the mantle upon my life, the realm of the spirit will open for me to discern what is upon your life or what is troubling you, and God can move. So when you honor the mantle of the man of God, you automatically open a door for yourself. Because you open the realm in the spirit where God will tell the man or woman of God, this is what is worrying my son or my daughter, and they can flow in that function.
Yes.
If you don't honor it, you come with a spirit of familiarity. God himself will shut the heaven against you because you are dishonoring his vessel.
Yes. My God. It's very important what she's saying. But before we continue, I want to just make a check. How many of you are being blessed this afternoon? Amen. How many of you are being blessed? Because, you know, when God is taking you to a dimension, it's about arise and shine. He will give you guidelines that will prevent you from failing. So God is really blessing us this afternoon by giving us, you know, these teachings are things that people go to certain conferences. They pay big money to enter the conference to get. But we are giving it here online for free.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah. By the way, speaking of free, I have a mentorship class that I do online, private group. If you have not become part of the mentorship classes, I encourage you to register today. For those in Europe, it's just 65 euros. For those out of Europe, it's 81 US dollars. Amen. It's easy to pay through my bank account, and the easiest way is through PayPal. I am telling you, encouraging you, join my mentorship classes. I want to raise you up by the power of God. I want to train you. I want to teach you. I want to mentor you. I want your light to shine. I want to give you guidelines that will help you to become the man or the woman that you need to be in this season. Amen. Help me share the group to your friends. Tell your friends about the group. It's time to grow. It's time to build. Some of you, your apostles, prophets are telling you not to join me, not to listen to me. But you are killing yourself because I have the God of Israel in me. I am a woman of the word. And as you can see, my light is shining. And you want to connect with somebody that has the kind of light that you desire to have, and even a double portion of the light. Don't be a person who settles for crumbs, but be a person who wants it all in the season. And how you have it all is by connecting to the right people. I'm a woman, but God is using me to do great things. You need to connect to such a person and build your life. If you are a woman and you desire what I do, and you are letting people to make you not to connect to me, Satan is lying to you. Mm-hmm. He comes to kill, steal, and destroy. And he doesn't want you to get truth, because only the truth is going to set you free. Something funny is happening on my screen. There is a rainbow. I just look on the screen, and there is a light of rainbow upon the screen. I'm telling you, we are in such a time where God is remembering his promises. This is not a prophetic moment. Those who will get it will get it. We are in a time, I'm telling you, I don't know if you can see it across my head. There is a line going throughout the screen. God is telling you, you are in the radar of God. God has remembered you. Mm-hmm. God is remembering his people. Mm-hmm. I don't know who this is for. I just saw the light, and we are talking about arise and shine. And God is saying, everything is being backed up by my promises.
Amen.
Everything God has told you, has promised you, is being backed up by the oath of God to see you through. God is going to give you that which you need in this season. I prophesy, I decree, and declare, you and your household will not lack, but you will go from one level to another level, from one dimension to the other dimension. God is loosing your hands for prosperity. Whatsoever you touch in this season is going to prosper. In the name of Jesus, is going to flourish. Even right now, some of you are receiving contractions. You are receiving contractions that will prepare you to begin to pray through your breakthrough. You are going to begin to prophesy, begin to decree, begin to declare. God is stirring up the water in you. God is stirring up the fire in you. God is stirring up the anointing in you. God is stirring your life up for change and for transformation. It is truly your time to arise and shine. You are a game changer. Somebody need to hashtag that. You are a game changer. When you came to town, you begin to change things in your family. Generations past, they were jacked up, they were in drugs, they were using voodoo, they were using witchcraft. And when you came, God said, through you, I'm going to change something. I'm going to break demonic things. I'm going to lift up a standard. Through you, you have the voice to pray any person in your family into the dimension that God wants them to be. But you need to take up your place. My God, you need to take your place and stand. After doing all you can, stand there. For after doing everything, the only way for you to proceed is to stand there. For it means you have to let go of emotionalism. You need to let go of witchcraft, let go of sexual immorality, let go of mundane talking. Don't talk like a chicken, but talk like the eagle that you are. Change your statements. Change the things you put on Facebook. Change your dimension. Don't follow quarries on Facebook. Don't follow lines of things on Facebook. But you, now you are a game changer. My God, I feel the anointing of God in this place. I feel the glory of God in this place. Thus said the Spirit of the God of Israel, I am raising up a curse breaker in you. I am raising up a game changer in you. With you, I will defeat nations that rise up against my body, says God to you today. Hallelujah. Thank you, Holy Ghost. I see people picking up their mantle. Manto ricado zakade. I see Morusa Karuze Keruza Kadaguza Kade. Mante Labakuza Kadirubuka Shataya. Mante Brando Zakade Zikateri Kata. Rigogo Jalebo. Mente Baka Terebo. Pare Zikata. Nelly, I speak to your back pain. I command healing in the name of Jesus. I command the hand of Satan to be taken off you in the name of Jesus. Any power that wants to come and destroy your process in God. I rebuke it in the name of Jesus. I say no weapon formed against you shall prosper. I release the hand of God, the power of God, the anointing of God, the name of Jesus upon your back right now, Nelly. Receive your healing in Jesus' name. Pick up your bed and walk up. I break anything in your life that is not of God. I break suicide spirit in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Maro Sarabakaya. Father, just pray for people right now that God will begin to activate them.
Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, we just receive, my God, we just release your people, my God, into a higher realm today, God. Father, we speak against any hand. We speak against any place of the earth, my God, where all the blood has been poured out to stagnate them, my God. Father, we call upon the blood today to release your people and propel them into purpose, God. Father, we speak into the atmosphere, Lord Jesus. We say, let them be released, God. We speak into every dead womb, today, from today onward, your belly, living water will flow out of your belly. From today onward, living water will flow out of your belly. May the blood of Jesus wash your belly today. Let that womb, my God, today be cleansed. We call upon the fire right now. Let the fire of God go into that womb, the womb that has spoken God over. Today, in the name of Jesus, we say the womb will receive a baby. Father, today that woman, my God, that barrenness has been cursed, as a curse has come upon her, whether it be spiritual barrenness, whether it be natural barrenness, God. Father, we are speaking today no more stagnation in her womb. We are speaking fruitfulness, Lord. My God, your people will no longer be limited. We say today by the breaker's anointing, they are broken free, oh God, from the hedge of the enemy, from the chains of the enemy. Father, today we call your sword. Let the sword of the Lord go ahead, my God. Let the sword of the Lord do its bidding. Whatever the Lord has decreed and declared upon the sword, let it go in your family background and cut chains over your children and cut chains over your husband. My God, today we pray, Father, that your kings will arise. That kings will arise, Father. That kings will arise in this place and take their place in the place of rulership. God, we pray for the women that they will arise and not only shine, but they will propel, my God, that they will go forward. They will stand as a light, my God. My God, those who have been sleeping, let life come upon them. We call the four winds of the earth. Let it breathe the work of God. Let it breathe the work of God. Wherever their muscles were weak, Father, let your breath breathe upon them now. Father, wherever, my God, may you put sin upon them, my God. Wherever they were weakened spiritually, my God, that because their muscles were weakened spiritually and they could no longer stand up, they could no longer move their hands, they could no longer speak, God. But God, today we say, in the name of Jesus Christ, that new vessels is coming upon them, new muscles is coming upon them, Lord, new spiritual muscles is coming, so that they will arise and become an exceedingly great army. Father, they will arise and become an exceedingly great army. Lord, today we pray for those who have been fragmented. Father, you made me understand in Ezekiel 36 that they were up fragmented all over the nations. My God, those who are fragmented into different parts, Lord, we call your wind to blow profusely. May your wind go and blow and gather them and bring them back to their right place. May your wind blow into them, Lord. Let there be a rattling right now. Let there be a rattling right now. Connecting the bones to the bones. Connecting the arms to the arms, Lord. Wherever they were fragmented in ministry. Wherever they were fragmented in life. That the enemy came and cursed their ground. But God, today by your wind. God, today by your lightning. We say we break the hands of the enemy off. And we align them back into position. We bring them into place of focus. We bring them into place of stability. We bring them into place, my God. When their eyes will see you, my Father, their eyes will see their future. In the name of Jesus Christ, my God, I want to pray for the teenagers, my God, those who are going, that have been called into ministry, that God, because of peer pressure, they don't want to come, my God, because of what their parents went through, they don't want to come, God, but God, today we are saying, the hands of Satan be loose, we say the hands of Satan loose our children. In the mighty name of Jesus, they are coming, my God. They are coming because we are arising and shining. They are coming to themselves, my God. Their mind is returning to themselves. No more suicide. We cancel the spirit of suicide that is taking the youngsters untimely, God. Jesus, you die untimely.
Yes,
that they will live long life. Father, we pray today that women will no longer be limited. They will know you called them. It's not for nothing that you allow women to see you come out of the grave first, God. Father, it was for a purpose, for them to know that they belong. It was a woman that anointed your feet to the grave, to the cross, God. It was a woman that prepared your burial. So today we are saying, let the women arise and shine. We are saying, let them take their position in their marriages. We are saying, let them take position in the marketplace. May you raise up marketplace prophets, my God. It is not only the pulpit you want to raise in this hour. God, you want to raise marketplace prophets. Those who will go into boardrooms, God, and decree and declare what God saith the Lord. My Father, today you raise them up. Marketplace prophets. School ground prophets, God. Father, apostles, I will be on my Father. Evangelists, I will go into the world. Father, today may you raise a fivefold again. Jesus Christ, the woman in Luke 13, my God, was bound by the spirit of infirmity for 18 years. But the day your hand touched her, she arose and started worshiping. My God, her purpose was called for because your hands was upon her. So today we pray for every person online that has been bent down by infirmity, that their head has been downward. Father, we decree and declare to their upwardness that they are going to arise, my God, and they are going to start functioning in purpose. Father, from today onward, we break the spirit of stagnation.
Yes,
we break the spirit of limitation. Father, we break the spirit of drowsiness. For those who want to read your word and they fall asleep. My God, today that spirit of drowsiness, we send you back to the pit of hell. Father, we break the spirit of misunderstanding.
Baba 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 santo robo shante reba kasante oba kasante robo kosente o raba sante rebe. Come on, people, begin to pray. Raba kosende rebeke endoria kabasante robo koshante raba. Father, we break stagnation. We lose your people this afternoon, God. Manta ribo ko sakaruba kashante rebe mante rebo ko. Body on this broadcast, Lord, I prophesy your fresh wind upon them. I prophesy your power upon them. I prophesy your glory upon them. I release your healing power upon them, Lord. I release your anointing upon them, oh God. I release it, God. And I decree and declare in this season, my God, your nations, your people, my God, they will arise and begin to shine. They will arise, no more stagnation, no more being hidden. But I'm calling the people, I'm calling the prophets, I'm calling them to call forth. Let them call forth in the name of Jesus. Let them call forth.
In the river, Sunday, be arising today, God.
Let them. I want us to pray for the men.
Yes, Lord.
That the men will arise and take their place. Pray for the men.
Father, today in the name of Jesus, Father, you said the men are the priests of their home. Father, today you said call forth the kings. So, Father, today in the name of Jesus Christ, we want to call the men to arise and shine. Father, we want to call them to the place of leadership. My Father, today we say, oh Lord, for the man that has been broken, for the man that curses has reigned because of one thing or the other, that God, today we say, oh God, that they are no longer unstable. Father, we call the spirit of stability to come upon them in the name of Jesus. My God and my Father, wherever the man of God were grand curses, where curses was rained upon them, oh God, maybe by somebody in authority, maybe in the time of their childhood when they made a mistake, but God, by the power and the blood of Jesus, we say, let every curse be wiped out. We say, let every curse be wiped out. And we say, let the blood of Jesus Christ, let it start speaking, oh God, rightful things today in the name of Jesus Christ. Let the blood of Jesus start speaking better things in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Let the blood of Jesus start speaking better things in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. In the name of Jesus, we pray today for the Rubens, that they were cursed to be unstable, that they were cursed by their fathers to be unstable. Father, today you were speaking to me about the Rubens. You said so many of your sons are cursed because of the mistake they did to their fathers. And they cursed them, my God, to be unstable. And they cursed them, my God, to be vagabond. And they are wandering out there for nobody to locate them. But God, today we sound an alarm in their spirit that from today onward, the Rubens out there that has been cursed to be unstable, that there will come stability in them. Father, we speak today, oh Lord, that they will no longer have war in their spirit. They will no longer have, my God, become reaching at the edge of their breakthrough, my God, and it is taken away from them. God, today we say they will arise and shine. So many of the men will come at the edge of their breakthrough because there is a curse upon them like Reuben, and they will quit, God. So, Father, we cry out for this man. We cry out for the Reuben of this season. And we say, God, forgive them. We say, mercy, oh God. We say, mercy, oh God. In the place where they wronged you, in the place where they wronged their fathers, we say, mercy, oh God. In the place where they wronged the women of their lives, in the place where they just wronged somebody in authority, may God, today we say, mercy. Let mercy speak for them, Lord. In the name of Jesus Christ, Father, we bless them today with the blessings of the Lord that maketh a man's life rich.
Yes, Lord.
And add no sorrow. We remove sorrow from the hearts of the men.
Yes, Lord.
We remove sorrow, God. We remove sorrow, God. Even divorce have made some of them so mad. Father, even I was talking to a father yesterday. He said, I'm divorced and I don't know what to do with my 6 children. He said, I am starting all over again. Father, his heart was breaking. There were so many men like him. Their heart is shattered. They don't know where they are going to start again. Their God, you are calling them to arise. Even they were as small as Gideon. Even they are unknown like Gideon. But God, today release your angel. Go and speak upon them and call them mighty men of valor.
Yes, God.
Father, to go and call them to say, arise and shine.
Yes,
for it is time for you to go and destroy the idols of your father's house so that you can lead them to the future. So that you can lead them to the future. God, cause our men to arise, oh God. Father, those who have the mantle like Gideon, let them go back to their father's house and destroy the idols. so that many will be liberated, many will be set free, for the next generation to be propelling forward, God. Father, for the man that is thinking about suicide, saying, I am nobody, saying, I am nothing, I have been on drugs for too long, and I have no hope, because I have no family, because I have no child, God, today we pray, go into that bedroom right now and speak to him and say, you are my son. Father, today release an angel to go and knock at the door. Father, it doesn't matter which vessel you use. He said, it's not your will for any soul to perish, that all will come to you, God. Stretch out your arms today, God. Stretch out your arms today, God. Even for the wanderers, my God, the madmen on the street, walking aimlessly, your hands are not too short, God. You said this is a supernatural season. So God, transcend the barriers and deliver our men in Jesus' name.
Father God, we just pray for our sons. We pray for our sons, yes, no matter how old they are. Let the anointing, the spirit,
yes,
grace and mercy of God the Father, the Son,
yes, Lord,
and the Holy Ghost fall upon our sons. Wherever our sons are at this moment, God, we lift them in front of you, God. Yes, sorry. We lift our sons, yes, in front of you, God. We cry out for mercy for our sons. Our natural sons and our spiritual sons, we cry out for mercy upon them. God, forgive their sins, we pray, the Lord. Forgive their sins. We ask the Lord in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. We bring our sons and we ask you that this day, Lord, you will touch our sons and give them an encounter with you, Lord. Let God touch our sons from the crown of their head to the soles of their feet. Let God touch the hearts of our sons, the minds of our sons, the spirit and the souls of our sons be touched today by God, Lord. Those that are disappointed and don't know what to do, Father, we call you, oh God, your hands, your healing hands, your saving hands to reach out to our sons and grab them by their right hand and lead them home, Father. Show them the right way. My God, lead them by your spirit and by your word. Even in their dreams, God, let our sons encounter you. Your son, Jesus, let them see him and know him as the savior of their soul. And let them be obedient, God, to the leading of your son and your spirit. And let our sons turn their hearts back to God, Father God. Restore our sons, oh God. We bind any spirit of antichrist that might have come upon our sons, my God, to get their hearts, oh God. We release the blood of Jesus, the blood of Jesus upon our sons, Father God. We release it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that our sons be saved and be kept and protected by you, Father God. Those sons who are in drugs, oh God, we call you today and we say, God, deliver them from this addiction. Let drugs become bitter in their mouth, oh God. Bitter in their system, my God. Those who are bound by alcohol, God, deliver our sons. Sanctify them, those who are bound by sexual immorality or grabbed by the wrong woman. Today, let there be a deliverance and a setting free. By Maruzika Bayebo Shekerebo. Father, we call and we ask you in the name of Jesus, set our sons free. Set the captives free. We call forth for a mighty worldwide deliverance of sons. Sons and daughters be restored by God. Father, you say in your word, I will fight them that fight you and I will save your children. Father, save our children. Deliver them from evil. We stand in the gap for them, my God. We say, Lord, be merciful unto us and unto our children. And the errors that we made a mistake, that our children flee from you and flee from us, Father. We ask for forgiveness, God. We ask that today you forgive us in Jesus' name. We ask you, Father. We ask in Jesus' name, God. Let there be deliverance upon Mount Zion, God. Yes. Father, have your way in our lives. Have your way in the lives of our children. Father, we cry out today, God, that our nations will know you. Yes. We cry out today, God, that our young ones, our youth will know you. I decree this morning time for New Zealand, that radical youth are rising up. Radical young ones. Prophets, can you just pray and decree this morning time? I was speaking to my spiritual children in New Zealand, and I felt that radical youth were rising up.
Amen.
Let's take 5 minutes and just tear it up in the spirit. Can you do that for us?
Yes, Father, Lord, we thank you. We thank you for the hour we are spending with you, Lord. Father, we just lift up all the youngsters before you, oh God. Father, we are calling the radical youth, my God. We are calling them to arise, Father God. Father, we are calling them those like David, my God, that you have trained on the background, my God, that you are bringing them forth with no fear. You are bringing them forth to face the Goliath, my God. Father, we are calling forth worldwide, my God. Father, of the four corner of the world, God, we are saying, let the radical youth arise. Let the radical youth arise, my God. Let there be ones that arise like Elisha. Let the youth that arise like David, my God. Let the Samuel of these days arise, my God. My God, those who stand before you, oh God, who stand before your people with no fear. My God, those who have been trained, my God. My God, radical you like John the Baptist, my God. Those who have been trained even in the wilderness, my Father, because of the things they have gone through life. Father, we are calling them for God. And we are praying for the radical youth to arise. As we are praying for them, God, we say, prepare your church. Prepare your church because the radical youth are coming. They are coming with what eyes have not seen. They are coming with what ears have not heard. They are coming with what has not entered into the heart of man. They are coming with a new you are pouring in this season. They were coming with a different kind of anointing. They are coming with their own mantle like David. That they are not going to wear the Saul's mantle, God. The radical youth are coming with their own weapons. The one that you have used to train them, God. It will not look like the weapons we know in churches. But it will look like the weapons you train them in wilderness. My God, prepare the radical youth and prepare the body of Christ, oh God, so that we'll be able to receive them, God, and don't send them back to the world. My God, as the radical youth are rising, my Father, my God, I see them coming in a thousand. My God, that those who will stand like Joshua to take the next generation into the promised land. The radical youth are coming, God. My Father, today we say, prepare the body of Christ. As you are raising the youth, my God, as you are bringing them up like Joshua, as you are speaking into them your fire, Father, those that will command the sun to stand still and it stands. My God, those that will open the Red Sea. My God, those that will command the star to twirl, my God. Father, these are the youth you are raising in this season. My God, prepare the body of Christ. That when these radical ones are coming, we will not take judgmental mind and push them away. My God, as they are rising up, we pray for strength. We pray for spiritual insight. We pray, oh God, for the heart of humbleness. We pray, oh God, that we will see them. We will see them through your eyes, my God. Father, they are coming, my God. You are saving the homosexuals, God. You are saving them, my God, in numbers. You are saving them, my God, in thousands. My God, you are pulling them to you. You are saving murderers like you did Saul to Paul. My God, they are coming in numbers. I see even the prison doors are opening. That you are going to open the prison doors of the youth. That the youth prison, my God, they are going to be radical youth. Coming out of prison. Coming tattoo from head to toe. But God, in this season, we will not reject them. My God, give us an eye to see that the prison doors are opening. That the doors is opening in the spirit. That the prison door is opening in the natural. My God, they are coming with no leaf in their mouth. They are coming to speak what thus saith the Lord. My God, the radical news. Youth, my God, that will see and heaven open. And miracles, signs, and wonders happen. My God, today we press in. And we say we receive them. We receive them, my God. But those who have been bound with drugs, that they will drop it in one day and say, I am going for Jesus. My God, when they come, we should not reject them. Because this one that you are raising in this hour, God, they are coming with a double-edged sword. They are coming with a fiery sword. They are coming with your seven spirits, God. They are coming, my God, radically in this season. My God, open our eyes as a church. Open our eyes as parents. That when it is happening in our own homes, we will not take the spirit of familiarity and break them. My God, as you are raising the radical youths, give us discernment, Lord. Because the prison doors are opening. Because whatever prison it is, my God, whether it is homosexual, God, whether it is sexual immorality, my God, still whatever it is, your slumber, disobedience, natural prison, Father, they are coming out. Because I see the prison doors opening, Lord. You are bringing them out in numbers. You are bringing them, my God, for the nations. They have gone through fire. They have gone through fire. They have gone through fire. But God is saying they are coming in this season, God, to put the nations, oh God, and build them for you.
Yes, Lord. Father, in the name of
Father, we thank you. And we thank you because you are the one bringing them.
Yes.
And prepare us, oh God. Make us ready for them, Lord. In Jesus' name. For them.
I just heard this sound. It's a clarion call. We are going to blow this and then the sofa, and then we are going to superimpose that people.
Oh God, let your people awaken.
Jesus! Glory!
Rabba Santa 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 Rabba Santa
Come on, decree an awakening wherever you are right now. Come on. Arise and shine. God is calling you. Jesus, 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 heal your people, God. Heal the nations. Oh, Yoyarabasa. Oh, Shanderebeko Santaya. Shanderebose. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Arise in our nations, God. Arise. Cause your bride to arise and shine again. Jesus. Come on, where you are, begin to decree, proclaim. Proclaim, let the heavens open. Let the heavens open. And the King of Glory come down. Visit us again, Lord. Visit our nations again, Lord. Visit my life. Holy Shataya. Zaloboke Serebosa. Marabakandorobose.
Mantos. Yes,
Lord. Thank you, Holy Ghost.
Thank you, God.
We worship you, Jesus. Oh my God. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Father, for this moment.
Thank you,
Lord. Father, let this sound open the realms of the spirit wherever your children are right now. Holy Spirit, move. If you don't know Jesus Christ, or you know him, you are playing with your life and salvation. Join Jesus 100% today.
Amen.
Turn your life to God. Flee from the things of the world. Go down to your knees and say, God, I need you, God. Need you.
Yes, Lord.
Oh, I need you. Yes, Lord.
Yes.
Yes, Lord. We need you, Lord. We need you, Lord. Morababoro shere devosa. Oh, Rabbi Yase. Commit your works to God. Commit your deeds to God. Turn back to God 100%. Don't go to voodoo or juju or anything. Go to God. Cry out to him. Sister Tinike, cry out to God. Cry out to God. Wherever you are right now, cry out to God. Cry out to God. God is calling us.
God is shifting. There's so much shift in the atmosphere. I just see new mantles. God is shifting his people and giving them new mantles. It's fresh men. This is such a glorious moment.
Oh, thank you, Jesus. God is so faithful.
Amen.
We just wanted to come out here and bless you on this Sunday. We just wanted to come out and tell you, it is your time to arise and shine. I am saying it. Prophetess Sally has been proclaiming it. Go back and read Isaiah 60 and embrace it.
Amen.
Embrace it. Stand in your family. Stand in your city. Stand in your nation. Wherever you are, it's time to stand up. Let the real you stand up. Let the real you take your place. Arise. Arise from depression. Arise from oppression. Arise from prison gates. Arise. And rise and shine.
Amen.
May you hear this word even in your dream, your spirit, when you are sleeping. Hear the word of God for you. Arise and shine.
Amen.
Arise and shine.
Amen.
It is your time to rise and shine from poverty into prosperity.
Arise
and shine. It is your time. It is your season. Don't miss this season. Don't miss this season. But shine for God. Let everything connected to you shine.
Amen.
Somebody needs to hashtag that. Everything connected to me shines.
Amen.
My children shine. My life shine. My finances shine. My ministry shine. My nation shine. My church shine. My spiritual children shine. My house shine. My glory shine. My star shine, my destiny shine, everything connected to me shines. Is somebody writing that down in the comment for yourself? Everything connected to me shines. Oh, thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Holy Ghost. My mindset shines. Everything connected to me shines. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Everything connected to me and you in this season. This is our winning season.
Amen.
Everything connected to us shines.
Amen.
Oh, thank you, Holy Ghost. I just want to give Prophet Sally 2 minutes to say a final word of advice and encouragement, and then we are going to close this session.
Amen. Christ, I just want to say thank you all for watching. The last thing I'm going to say is stay focused. Be focused. To arise means you have to be stable. Be stabilized and stay focused. So that when God arise, calls you to arise and shine, and you decide your choice. You make a choice today. God said, I present to you life and death, and I pray you choose life. So my prayer for you today is that you choose to arise and shine. Make a choice today. Say, I'm going to arise in my finances, in my life, in my ministry, in my home, in my marriage, at my job. I am going to arise and shine. And you start walking with your head tall.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Arise and shine. Walk with your head tall. So we just thank all of you for today. If this message has been a blessing to you and you have not shared it in your groups or on your timeline, kindly just click the share button and it's going to be shared. Amen. Your friends' inbox. Somebody will be blessed by this because of you. Amen. And if my ministry, our ministry is being a blessing to you, do not hesitate to sow a financial seed. Amen. If you want to sow a seed, write me and I'm going to send you our bank account, or you can bless us through PayPal. And we know that it's your season And you are a winner because God has called you to be a game changer. Be blessed and connect to my mentorship classes. And I see you soon. Amen and amen. So we are done for today. Hallelujah. Were you blessed? Where are my blessed people? Were you blessed? Let me see the comments. God bless you. Prasadu. Bless you. Prasadu, bless you. I see Jacqueline Martina online. God bless you. I see Sister Paulette online. Hey, Pastor Louis Rivers, where have you been? Been missing you. You are online today. I see Sister Paula online. I see Yvonne online. I see my new daughter Shanti online. I see Sister Nicoletti online. Mm-hmm. I see who else is online. Sister Tinike is online. I see Retty and Epeniza online. I see so many people. I see Brother Mark online. I see Nelly online. Who else do I see?
Charity. All
those who are commenting. I see Sister Janice online. I see my brother Samuel online. I see Anton online. Jesus. Bless you online. All. Thank you all for watching. Thank you all for sharing. Thank you all for supporting my ministry. Amen. Amen. God bless you all. Have a glorious service. Hallelujah. Sister Amen. Tinike said, I am blessed. So only Amen. One person is blessed. That devil is a liar. I asked who is blessed. Only one person said, I'm blessed. I'm going to wait until at least one more person. What?
I only know one person blessed. Brother Prasadu is blessed. Brother Prasadu is right from India.
Brother Prasadu?
Yeah, he's from India.
Okay, he's blessed. Only one person blessed. The devil is a liar. I rebuke it. Okay, Sister Paula said blessed. At least two people. Okay, my daughter Nelly said blessed. All right, now we are talking. I see all of you saying blessed.
Blessed.
I see my brother who lives in France is online. God bless you, Sam. I see. I'm blessed. Jacqueline is blessed. Yvonne is blessed. That's now we are talking. You wanted to make my Sunday depressed? No, I'm just joking. I'm just joking. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Wow. So it's been a great time with you all. Thank you for all that you do. Continue running for Christ and don't backslide. Amen.
Amen.
And I will see you all soon. Pastor Louis say bless, bless, bless. Bye, everybody. See you soon.
Bye, everybody.